Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Destruction of Justice by Lawrence Davis. Narrated by Rudy Sanda. Prologue. The abomination tearing down the rain-slicked street, sending shards of grit in every direction, was an unstoppable force. Bulbous, ape-like arms, ending in cruel, curved claws, found easy purchase on the street, twisting the asphalt into submission and launching the creature forward. Its reptilian head was thick with bone at the crest of its skull, and it had a broad snout full of jagged teeth that tore through everything that had been thrown at it so far. As if that wasn't enough, there was a spiked, three-pronged tail slashing behind it, each barb armed with a different venom. Gruesome stitching infused its hide with magical runework, showing the Frankensteinian beast for what it was, a collage of the most fearsome creatures in the realms, all patched together to create a singular killing machine. An idling truck lay ahead of it in the street, its frame battered from the fight. In the passenger seat, Johnny B. gripped the neck of his guitar and stared down the beast.
"Any ideas, Muscles?"
The soldier, sitting in the driver's seat, wouldn't have answered even if he'd heard the question. The elf seemed like a slight thing next to Grove, but he was tougher than he looked. The leather-clad goth rock and roller was just about to ask again when the engine roared as Grove floored it.
"Right," quipped the elven karaoke king. "We ram it. Brilliant."
Grove smashed the horn, cluing in the two others trying to stall the monster to his impending kamikaze attack. Only Xander could stand toe-to-toe with it for more than a minute, but with another thundering backhand, the monster sent that burly shapeshifter tumbling into a lamppost, its flickering light extinguished like the last vestige of fight in him. The regulator stood nearly 8 feet tall in that form when upright, yet this hodgepodge creature towered over him. Even with Xander's supernatural speed, it seemed able to track and intercept his every approach with a well-timed swat. The scent of a near kill proved too irresistible, though, so when the truck barreling down the proverbial pipeline came within striking distance, the aberration couldn't act quick enough, fixated as it was on its fallen prey. Grove snatched Johnny by his studded collar and dragged them both out the open door, or rather, the opening that remained after the door had been torn away in an earlier skirmish. The SUV smashed headlong into the beast's colossal body, crashing to a cold stop from 60 miles an hour. Thick arms clutched the flanks of the battered vehicle, crunching the side paneling and collapsing the frame, reducing the once mighty vehicle into an oversized accordion. Xander, his canine head bloodied, turned to watch the savagery as the beast shredded the truck. The concrete monk lay motionless on the other side of the road beside a bloodied brick wall, unconscious and face down in grime. The man had managed to stave off the nightmare on his own for longer than any of the rest could. Johnny B., the last one still largely unscathed, straddled Grove, who had taken the brunt of the beating from their impromptu exodus from the truck.
"Come on,"
he said, frantically trying to pat down the hard-bodied warrior. Both of them soaked, in the middle of the road, a flamboyantly dressed elf straddling him. It might be hard to live down on another night, but this night was different. Tonight was the night they'd tried to put themselves between a friend and a blind judge, the enforcer of the in-between's laws, a juggernaut sent to deliver the council's judgment to those who dared disturb the precious balance. Barely conscious, the soldier spat a mouthful of blood while pawing weakly at one of the magazine holsters on his hip. Luckily, Johnny B. seemed to take the cue for what it was, scrambling to flip it open just as the gigantic surgical nightmare shifted its possessed, narrow-slitted eyes to them. Johnny B. started crooning a slowed-down rendition of Bon Jovi's Blaze of Glory. There was nothing commercial about his solemn reimagining of the song. A shaky hand retrieved the gadget stowed away in the magazine holster, a small black device with a big red switch on its side. With an awareness no mere beast should have possessed, the monster's eyes widened just as the punk rock elf flipped the switch, A devil-may-care smile plastered across his face. Just down the road, Janzen was fighting against the hammering of his heart, the boil of his blood, and the burn of each struggling gasp of air while sprinting to try to help his friends, his people, his family. Close enough for a front row view, but too far away to offer any kind of help, he felt a wave of heat from the explosion as it washed over his rain-streaked face, illuminating an expression of pure horror. The blind judge, huddling around the mangled truck, surrounded by his closest confidants, his dearest friends, stood at the heart of a gigantic fireball some 4 stories high. The aftermath left smoldering asphalt, flipped cars, sheared and broken telephone poles, and shattered windows as far as the eye could see. Behind him was a puddle-rumbling boom, then another. The fire hissing in the distance had nothing on the one in Janzen's steely eyes.
"You!"
Janzen heard himself say, though the voice couldn't have belonged to him. The wet in his eyes wasn't from the heavy rain, and the rage that flowed through his veins was too much to keep bottled up. Behind him stood a towering machine, a dire contrast to the beast at the center of the eruption. Where the latter was a network of limbs and parts scavenged from enslaved beasts, this golem was forged from mythical metal and shaped carefully into an indestructible tank. Its expressionless countenance was illuminated by the rich sigil work etched across its behemoth metal mass. A second blind judge squared off with the artificer. Alone. Again. Chapter 1. 2 days earlier.
You could use this for, like, so much stuff. I mean, anything. Corporate espionage I would have been okay with.
Grove had the bastard I was berating in a hurt lock, making him a captive audience to my monologue. The scumbag in question was Nicholas Green. Late 20s, greasy black hair, unflattering clothes. He had that whole I live in my parents' basement vibe. He was gangly and malnourished, and his room looked like an altar to off-brand energy drinks and discount pizza. If I was going to give the word disappointing a face, his would be it. But spying on babysitters and moms? Come on, man. I looked at my hands. In one was a mason jar full of some kind of gunk. He'd called it an elixir. In the other, I held a soldier figurine, which I waved at Grove.
Kind of looks like you.
Grove glowered at me and tightened his grip, squeezing an unflattering yelp from Nick. Being pinned between my buff business partner and a computer desk wasn't an enviable position. So with this stuff, I lifted the jar, you can form a psychic connection? Next, the toy soldier. And with some focus, you can actually see what it is he's seeing? That's a nifty trick, man. Real nifty. How'd you even figure this out? With a theatrical sigh, I gave him a look of doubt before nodding for Grove to relent. Not without his own qualms about it. He more shoved than released Nicholas. We were both a little peeved. This case was earning us pennies on the dollar because we'd taken it from a scared 16-year-old girl. She swore to us that a toy kept creeping around the house of the kid she'd been babysitting, and it got so bad that she was starting to have nervous breakdowns. The once valedictorian-bound teenager was now being drug-tested by her exhausted parents and counseled by an overpriced shrink who kept reinforcing the suspicion that she was, in fact, crazy. At first, we had no idea how to approach the case. How do you catch a phantom stalker? Turned out, it wasn't hard, and didn't involve magic at all, just some rudimentary detective work. Nick here was quite a fan of hers on Instagram, and he'd left a trail of electronic hearts a mile wide leading us right to his door.
Talk.
This whole pathetic social outcast thing doesn't earn you much sympathy with us. You were stalking a 16-year-old, Nicholas. That's fucked up. You should probably get some help before you hurt somebody worse than you already have. or somebody hurts you worse than we already have. After a beat to let the threat sink in, I held the jar up.
How'd you get this?
I bought it,
he said in a sullen tone. My silent partner complimented my sour look with a slap to the back of Nick's head. We made a good team in this respect. Everything else was a damned disaster. Still, when it came to the presentation of a unified front, we couldn't be outdone.
Ow! What? I did!
If he's gotta hit you for every snide remark you make, this is going to be a long day. And, as of an hour ago, we switched from the young lady's dollar to yours.
That's not fair!
Grove slapped him again. Couldn't tell you how he knew to do that one. Just a sense, I suppose.
I bought it,
he whined, rubbing the back of his head, shifting a sneer to the bruiser behind him.
At that carnival thing that just came through. Some guy way in the back. He made a big thing about being able to see through the eyes of all. I don't know. Seemed hokey until he grabbed me with some of that stuff on his hand and I could see me through his eyes. It was kind of creepy, but cool.
Interesting. Something like this wasn't a cheap parlor trick.
How much?
$5,000.
$5,000? How the hell did you manage $5,000?
I designed games,
he said, gesturing to a poster hung up on the far wall. It was Kingdom Killer, a wicked game about a wronged barbarian gaining hellish power in order to take down the establishment that wiped out his archaic tribe. I was in the middle of playing it through for my third time.
No way! I love that game!
Holy crap, how do I slay
Grove cleared his throat.
Right. Okay, so you bought this stuff, and I assume he gave you instructions for using it?
Yeah, he told me the whole, way to use it, what to do, everything.
Cradling the mason jar of pungent-smelling goo, I screwed the lid on and turned all of my attention on the kid.
Tell me everything.
Daydreaming was one of my least favorite habits, but one I caught myself doing frequently. I found my stupor interrupted when Grove took his hand off the steering wheel and pointed to the jar I'd been staring at. Grove was young, but only in body. His eyes had a clear-sightedness that spoke volumes. We'd spent the last few months as partners, working and living together, building a rapport that was quickly becoming seamless. Small stuff is easier to control, but apparently the drawback is this stuff's exhausting for even a little bit, I said. I'd gotten a kind of cursory breakdown of how the goo worked from the twerp we'd snatched it from. Not sure how it works, and it's gotta be some incredible stuff if it's able to give a passageway to power for someone who isn't naturally gifted. The more you use, the more you can control, the more it'll drain out of you. I suspect it's habit-forming. We'd installed a tablet on the center console which picked up on what I said and relayed it to Grove with closed captions. Probably not ideal for driving, but it was far more reliable than lip-reading. I caught a glimpse of his face. His expression was quizzical, not skeptical. We had too much trust for that, at this point, though it was good to see him starting to question everything with a newly educated mind. Grove didn't have any magical talent. For him, this was all a scholarly pursuit. It was easier to fight something you knew, and although we hadn't come across anything heavy since the Stalker, it was good to see the Boy Scout sticking true to the old motto, "Be prepared."
Did you see him?
Clothing loose, unwashed, like he's been ignoring basic hygiene and not taking care of himself. For him to be able to write code and design on that level takes solid know-how. I know a lot of those guys tend to be reclusive, and that contrary to popular belief, even though their community is tight-knit, they do go out. He's been fixated on this stuff. And even when you had him twisted like a pretzel, he was seriously considering making a grab for it. He was acting like an addict. My guess is that this guy gave him just enough to get him hooked, and he knew he'd have a customer for life. So, the next time that carnival comes to town, we'll be there. My hope was that the kid would be back to himself in a bit.
I might not have the most intimate knowledge of magical mechanics, but I did know the most fundamental principle: give something to get something. The ins and outs of a hustle I completely understood, and in this case, a lot of the trade-off was dangerously close to being one-sided. This stuff was the equivalent of a gateway drug, one where the price it extracted was far more insidious than the user was conscious of. The longer a person used it, the more they wanted. And when they got desperate enough for more, they would reach into darker and darker places to re-experience the power they had come to love. I called the client and told her she was off the hook for the bill and that what she'd been seeing was some wonky gizmo created by a local pervert, basically a toy drone, and that now it was destroyed. An explanation that was more within her realm of understanding than the truth. I stuck the perp with a hefty bill. I wasn't running a charity, and I figured if he could pay $5,000 for the stuff, he could certainly pay my fee. This solution was better than a beatdown, although I hadn't ruled that out if he failed to comply. Cleveland had a way of imprinting itself on those of us who came up there. We're a sturdy people. Usually a bit too blunt or abrasive, and we skew pretty blue-collar. It was a tough town, but I don't know if I would want to live anywhere else, crazy as I'm told that is. Our shop was right outside downtown, a little north toward the industrial side of the city. Circle Protection Agency was a play on the fact that my work as an artificer all begins with a circle. The shape was the oldest ward known to mankind, predating written language. Ours wasn't a big spot, just two window panels with our logo and the company name above it. The door was framed in old brick, with a dedication plaque mounted beside it. It was our touchstone, literally. Grove and I each placed our hands on it every time we entered the building. When we first came together as a team, we'd done so with a third person, the person who'd brought us together. At the end of one very rough week, we ended up losing her, but not before she quite literally saved the city. Maybe more. It was heavy stuff, especially since we specialized in the proverbial lower end of the totem pole. We dealt mostly with minor wayward beasties, novice practitioners making trouble, or every now and then, something like what was laid at our feet today. Inside was a 15 by 15 foot room. The desks in the middle faced each other. In the back, we had a couple of blackboards. One where we collected our scattered writings, theories, and sightings. Next to that was another board where we pinned articles about local goings-on and settled cases. In the middle were cases that still seemed to be pending or problematic, ones that we'd yet to resolve. There was a narrow hallway off that wall which led to a second room, an annex where we worked out and trained. Since taking on Grove, I'd stepped up my own fitness routine. By stepped up, I mean I went from 12-ounce curls at the bar to actual weightlifting and running, although both of us found that we had a few things to teach each other when sparring. For my part, I'd been tutoring Grove on what I knew of the world beneath the world we lived in. We talked of lore, separating fact and fiction. I'd attempted to show him the rudimentary breakdown of artificing, but that took a kind of skill that was impossible to teach. It was a gift. Without overcomplicating it, sigils had base templates to draw from. From there, a person had to feel the way the magic infused an item and inscribe runes using a kind of sixth sense. I took to it criminally fast. Especially since I never really became the prodigal son that some people expected I might, but for most, it took a long time. It wasn't in the cards for Grove, though, and that didn't seem to bother him in the least. "What are you thinking, food-wise?" Grove unholstered a pistol and cleared it, taking the round out of the chamber and setting it down on his desktop. While he thumbed through menus, I pressed play on the answering machine. The contraption was old school, especially in the age of cell phones, but we were both equally paranoid and preferred to keep it low-tech in the office. Grove's paranoia was born from Big Brother, mine from the boogeyman. Same phobia, different mask.
Maybe even try our luck at the last l-
The door banged sharply. It smacked the wall hard enough off that it almost ricocheted back into the face of the two figures bursting through. Luckily, the woman had enough of her wits about her to catch the door before it could crack her right on her full head of scarlet hair on the way back. The intercepting hand left a print of blood, which smeared as her weak arm slid down from the exertion of even having to lift it. She was beautiful in an ageless way, with exotic eyes that stabbed straight to your fast-beating heart and seized it still. Gale was a big fish in a small pond here in Cleveland. She was without rival in terms of raw power as well as knowledge, as far as I could tell. The last time I'd seen her magic at work, she was able to fight a godling to a stalemate before finally relinquishing some ground, but never giving it over. A feat so impressive I hadn't the right kind of eloquence, or time, to really impart just how awe-inspiring an accomplishment it was. When she stood upright, she was just shy of 6 feet tall. But right now, she was painfully hunched over, her body propped up by a much smaller man. Donovan was my new mentor, a master tinkerer and gnome with whom I met every week to refine my skills. Our lessons were usually tight-lipped and combative, but I was learning at too quick a pace to allow my pride to fuck it all up for me, no matter how badly I wanted to shove his head through the workbench. Both of them had the look of someone who'd come out the losing end of a bad fight, a look I'd worn all too often. Their abrupt entrance earned them the barrel of a gun from Grove, who, despite being aware of who they were, hadn't lowered it. Like I said, he's as good a partner as there could be. I had to admit that I was alert, and not just because of the way they looked. Donovan had swapped his usual stoicism for sincere panic, and he was straining to keep Gale off the floor. He had a pretty ugly wound in his left leg, and another on his right flank, which was gushing blood in rhythm with his elevated heart rate. My place was their last resort, which meant that whatever was after them came from official channels, or was just so big and bad that they were acting on pure survival instinct. Our silent stare-down said everything without any of us having to actually utter a word out loud. Gale was trying her best to keep some semblance of dignity about her. Her jaw clenched with effort as she fought to keep the pain off of her face, as if looking impassive would help anything. Pride is a funny, funny thing. Donovan, on the other hand, was easier to read than a pop-up book, which caught me by surprise. He usually had the kind of poker face that players at professional tournaments trained a lifetime to master. I looked at Grove, and when he finally acknowledged me, mouthed for him to get the med kit. One of the many benefits that came from having a partner with a military background was that we trained constantly, and prepared ourselves for every imaginable eventuality, with emergency medical care being near the top of the list. "Lockdown," I said. Another contingency laid out by my hypervigilant partner was a protocol to button us up. The last shred of bravado broke in Gale, and relief flooded over her bloodied body as I jogged past both of them to close and lock the door. I hit the switch next to it, which lifted a panel with a number pad on it. With an ease that came from muscle memory, since my stringent associate insisted on countless repetition, I punched in the code to put us on lockdown. Hurricane shutters slammed over both windows and the doorway. Inside, the electricity went off the grid, and a series of emergency lights popped on. I shoved Donovan aside and ahead of me, a little more roughly than I intended, and took his place under Gale's arm. She was taller than me, but even with her athletic build, she was feather light. I suspected she had some kind of hollow bones, like most elvish types, but now is not the time to ponder that. "Out of all the doors in all the city, you had to pick mine," I said. Despite the violence she had experienced, Gale smiled at my Bogart reference as I hustled us to the back. "I thought that would appeal to your inner gunslinger, and even more to your love of Casablanca." For a moment, I thought she was shrugging, but I realized she'd actually passed out cold. The back room was much bigger than the front, and every corner was filled with all kinds of training equipment, boxing gear,
replicated melee weapons, barbells, weights, and even a pair of cots for overnight duty. Donovan shot me a concerned look. I got the sense he didn't think this was the best place for us to stash Gale. I wrapped my other arm beneath her now limp legs and scooped her up. Grove started dragging away the old high school wrestling mats we'd bought from a shady second-hand store to reveal a large cellar door that led down to our sub-basement. "Take her," I said, handing Gale over to Grove, who was much more confident in his balance than I was. I waited at the top of the stairs and offered Donovan my shoulder, which he took with a pale hand. He thanked me with an appreciative look before we started down. Managing to get the best of a tinkerer was a big deal, especially on his home turf. There's no way Donovan didn't have his place warded to the proverbial nines to deal with any and all kinds of potential issues, which made this big deal even more impressive. Before they showed up at my door in this condition, the idea of handling the tinkerer and putting Gale on her ass simultaneously should have been impossible, yet here they were. The sub-basement was shaped like a big cylinder. It was an old bomb shelter built back before the city began regulating that sort of thing. Grove settled Gale on the bed we'd prepared and set to lighting torches. Donovan's dubious looks were starting to subside, but when the room lit up, they completely disappeared. I'd taken the time to carve, trace, and imprint every kind of sigil and rune I could find, from the most fastidious and archaic to the ever-evolving stuff being done at the few known institutions of magic. The trick was keeping to what I knew, which was subtle manipulation and craftiness. None of it was meant to thwart scrying eyes or repel an attack. All of it was misdirection and guile. It was designed to bounce a seeking spell on itself, cycling any energy signal so it constantly circled the very quarters they were inside. Determining where either of them was would be a nuisance and a major league pain in the ass for even the most accomplished practitioner. One sigil would redirect a spell into another sigil, which would in turn do the same to another, each of them imbued with a small sapping quality which wouldn't challenge the actual power of the casting, but instead weaken it with every deflection until it just evaporated. If you can't be strong, be smart. Normally, the impression of just how stunned my mentor was would be kind of a hallmark moment for me. But, given that this recent encounter had nearly killed Gale and had grievously wounded him, I didn't have time to gloat. "Sit down," I told Donovan. Before he could object, I shoved him down onto the foot of the other bed. Grove had laid Gale out carefully to examine her. Just before getting to work, he paused and gave me a wary eye. Luckily, as I said, we'd come to understand one another well enough to keep in sync. While I had his eye, I said, "She's still got a physical vessel. Same rules, amigo. If it's bleeding, it's bad. She's probably going to need an IV and some bandages." Donovan, a guardian of not only Gale's business but the woman herself, was about to voice a complaint when I tightened the tourniquet I'd slid up his diminutive leg while he was watching Grove work on her. It sank into sensitive flesh, cutting off the circulation and eliciting a yelp. Donovan was a gnome, but when they passed to our world, a kind of natural glamour concealed any of the telltale traits of his heritage that would make him stand out to us. Save, of course, his height.
"You could have warned me," he said.
"Right back at you. Stay here."
I climbed back up to seal the cellar door. The locking mechanism turned, setting into motion a steady soundtrack of bolts engaging before I returned. I wasn't too keen on locking myself inside as well, but given that this was a situation I knew quite literally nothing about and it was serious enough to bring these two clamoring to my doorstep half-dead, I figured it was time to exercise caution. "So," I said, plastering the most sarcastic grin I could muster across my face, "what's new with you?"
"We were attacked," he answered, his voice flat.
Gasping and wide-eyed, I covered my mouth in feigned shock before falling into a deadpan expression.
"You two what? Pissed off the stalker that got through the portal last winter and needed me to play cleanup?
Some old flame of Gale's doesn't want to pay alimony for their little hellspawns anymore?
Mrs. Neverblink think you and Gale got more than a working relationship? The last quip was for him. I probably shouldn't have been so cavalier, but annoying humor was a kind of defense mechanism for me. Some might argue that it's my default setting. So even if I wanted to curb my behavior, any attempt would just flat out fail. Everybody has their way of dealing with things, and this was my process.
Now.
Donovan's voice dropped an octave. His sunken shoulders fell even further, and a desperate expression washed over a face I was used to seeing as unflappable. He turned to watch Grove as he cut Gale out of her bloodied clothes and gently covered her with the blanket we'd laid at the end of the bed. It was really hard not to respect the guy. I decided to soften my approach and set aside my proclivity to remind the world what an asshole I am with every utterance and tried to usher Donovan back to the present with a reassuring hand on his small shoulder. Whatever it is, together we can—
She's being hunted by a blind judge.
And suddenly, I too felt the clutch of despair drag me down into hopelessness. For the first time in memory, I was rendered completely speechless. Chapter 2. Blind Judgment. That's impossible. I might have been gaping at Donovan for 1 minute or 10. It was hard to tell. That's like an act of... I mean, a blind judge?
It's true.
Downtrodden and dead-eyed, Donovan looked physically and spiritually exhausted.
I would know the dreadnought anywhere. That is what came for us.
Dreadnought?
How much do you know of the blind judges?
Like, nada.
Zachariah told me it's an inescapable death sentence. That's about it. Something about a house of gnomes or something and a tribe of goblins. Have some ritual trial about when the balance is broken, and they send their champion after the offender. Wasn't really in my wheelhouse. I feel like I've got the bones of it, but not much else.
That's the gist of it, yes. The in-between is the dividing space between our world, the Veil, the Abyss, and the Beyond. The Masarou tribe and the House of Unet are keepers of the balance. These two, the oldest goblin tribe and the royal line of gnomes, are in control of the judges. If there's an accusation, they take it under advisement, make a determination, and, if justified, decide which of the judges to send.
There's more than one?
Donovan nodded.
The one that came after us was from the House of Unet. Their champion is the Dreadnought. A golem of Earthcore steel.
Earthcore? So that's, like, good? Like, I paused, looking for the word. My forays into proper studies had been stunted, to put it kindly. Mithril?
Mithril? He asked, his tone unreadable.
Never mind. It's from the Lord of the Rings.
I'm aware, he said.
The gnome had managed to recover some of the condescending superiority I'd come to know and hate.
Yes, somewhat. It's particularly good steel. It's immune to the hottest of temperatures and tempered in such a way that the density is just astounding. Each limb weighs countless tons. They work anti-magic into every inch of it, too. It's resistant to almost every element, and all but impervious to traditional magic.
Oh, good. I thought this would be, you know, tough.
It's impossible. Why are you celebrating that? He asked.
Well, if it's impossible, it does tend to take a lot of the pressure to succeed off, I said flippantly. Donovan usually despised my capricious wit, but this time his disapproving stare shrank away. And the beaten-down tinkerer actually chuckled, if only at the absurdity of it all. So they send this thing after the big-time magic-wielding types, right? Donovan nodded. It's a single-minded wrecking ball? Another nod. All right. No strength comes without sacrifice, and that will mean a weakness. What do you know about it?
Nothing, to be truthful. What I do know is just on the fringe of my consciousness, he said.
That didn't make any sense. What do you mean?
I mean I don't know anything about it, even though I built it.
Donovan affixed an unflinching stare on me, his tone neutral. For the second time in the same hour, I had been struck speechless. I even found myself swaying back to better absorb the startling surprise.
You built it? The blind judge? That was you?
My animated zeal drew Grove's attention. I waved off his furrowed brow and confused expression, gesturing at Gale so that he kept his focus on her.
Well, not just me. I am an heir of Unet, albeit disgraced and disavowed, but one of the royals nonetheless. When my house exiled me, they took my knowledge of the golem before casting me out of the in-between, which was my home, into this place. I was the architect, though, yes.
Donovan looked past Grove to Gale. Despite being bloodied and bandaged, she seemed peaceful. Gale was an uncompromising pillar of strength and pride, but the one theme I'd been picking up on lately was her affinity for those who'd been cast out. Everyone in her circle was a kind of stray. Take Xander, for instance. His pack had actually run him out, and he'd basically become persona non grata before falling into the bar matron's lap. All of her people swore an oath of fealty to her out of adulation and appreciation instead of fear. And while there was a profound reverence for the woman, their obedience was a product of love.
Why? I asked. When I saw the confusion on Donovan's face, I clarified.
Why did they throw you out?
It's a long story. In short, I did something unbecoming of royalty. I fell in love with someone beneath my station and my heritage. Her name was Jasun. She was a goblin.
I was too warped myself to be judgmental about any kind of love story, but I was surprised that Donovan, usually so reserved, shared all of this so openly.
Love had a way of dispensing with one's usual reservations, I suppose. Jasun? Beautiful name.
I wasn't so absent of empathy that I couldn't extend a bit of kindness.
Donovan had really furthered my education in our craft, and with no real gain to speak of for himself. So, I continued carefully. I was already familiar with Donovan's pensive mask, so I strove to remain both patient and soft-spoken as I tried to walk him out of his thoughts. We have to figure out the procedure for this whole judge, jury, executioner thing and see if there isn't a way to slow it down or, I don't know, get a retrial. I rubbed my recently shaved head. Focusing on the prickly soft sensation was a nice way to get my mind working. This place will do for a spell, I said, wincing as I caught my own accidental pun. But with Gale's power signature, it's going to be hard to keep her concealed. Donovan raised a finger, then untucked a necklace from beneath his tattered shirt. The circular pendant contained an old emblem, one I wasn't able to recall from any of my studies. Before I could open my mouth, he answered the question written on my face.
It's a talisman. Her power is in this. Its signature is masked, although if they're close enough, they will still be able to pick up on it. It's a dampener, not a solution.
Knowing I'd regret it, I held my hand out expectantly.
Donovan looked from the opened palm to me, so I explained. This is one of the first places they'll snoop around. Best to keep them off the scent. Give it to me.
No,
he cried, betraying a shocking amount of passion for a man who always kept his cool.
This is my responsibility.
We locked eyes in a confrontation that felt almost physical. That was the very line I used when dragging Maria's lifeless body out of Lake Erie, barely managing with my one good arm, but determined to be the one who completed the task. I gave him a terse but unenthusiastic nod and stood up. Donovan moved again, but this time with his free hand, the one not clutching the pendant. If it was anyone else, I'd have ripped it out of their hand, but I realized the Master Tinkerer's solution was likely Gale's best bet to stay hidden, especially within the bunker's warren of misdirection wards.
"If you help us," he began to say.
"I'm picking a side, I know."
I stood, which got Grove's attention. I signed that we were heading out. In our ever-evolving process to find amicable middle ground, I had taken the time to learn some American Sign Language, while Grove had made it a point to be more expressive so I could pick up on his cues. For all the headache this kind of silent communication could create, it had its benefits, and as more time passed, we started to fall more and more in step with one another.
"Anything else you need to tell me about this?" I asked.
"It has something to do with the lake," he answered.
"Where we lost Maria.
The person who prompted us to start this crackpot company in the hope that we could help someone else should they ever find themselves in over their head. Of course, it was more aimed at maybe keeping some girl off the menu for a vampire or some guy from being cursed by an ex. Stepping into a vendetta set against a borderline demigod like Gale was above my pay grade, a fact that was now occurring to me for the second time, establishing a potentially troublesome trend. There's plenty of food and water. The bathroom doesn't have any water, but you can go up and get some. Everything is completely off the grid, and you should keep it that way." The gnome, apparently surprised by my willingness to help more than I already had, struggled to his feet, but every time the opportunity to thank me came up, I made sure to interrupt him. "Don't talk to anyone," I said as Grove started heading upstairs. "Make sure she's resting. If you need to get hold of me, you can't, but I'll check in on you with that." I pointed to the wall, where there was a metal box next to the medical kit.
"What is it? A portal? Some kind of security camera?"
"Not exactly." My sheepish response stoked his suspicion. Donovan went to the box, unclasped the metal latch, and pried it open. Inside was a styrofoam cup with a string pierced through the bottom and knotted off inside of it.
The look I got was perfectly contemptuous, which just spurred my smile.
"Really?"
he demanded.
"Yep.
No magic residue, no electronic signal, nothing to hack. That's what you never get, Sensei." That was a title he hated, and one I employed as often as appropriate comedic timing allowed. "The higher up a problem is," I said, illustrating my point with one hand stretching skyward, "the easier it is to crawl under it. You beat a big power with better technology by lowballing it. Scoff all you want. Nobody is going to detect that thing or find it except us."
It was a rare win. He seemed less stupefied and more begrudgingly impressed. I took the victory in stride, saving my shit-eating smile for when I turned to follow Grove out. It was important to appreciate something like that, since it seemed I was about to join the losing team in a one-sided beatdown against an undefeated adversary. You know, just another day at the office.
Chapter 3. The Last Love. Since my own version of the story was abbreviated, I parroted all of it back to Grove as best I could. When he asked me to explain the difference between something like a stalker and a blind judge, I explained it as the difference between a big jungle cat and a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Neither was ideal, both could kill us with ease, but one afforded a relatively more reasonable chance of survival than the other. We cleared off our joint desk and dropped an assortment of gear onto the surface. Grove had emptied out his savings to buy some really incredible body armor, thin as a sweater and scaled. The rifle Casey had given him was still a favorite. Its silver blade gleamed as he handled it. A spiked hammer coated in the same rich silver hung at his hip. I waited as Grove stashed a few other pistols and knives on his person. My setup was much the same. I secured the broken bat to my lower back across the line of my waist, then donned my leather bracer and satchel of marbles. My skeleton key necklace was refashioned, and recently I'd added two bracelets to my right arm where my broken watch used to sit. Once we had piled into our truck, I settled an aluminum bat between my legs.
Are we going to talk to Casey?
Grove asked. Casey was like a surrogate older sister. She owned the magic shop across the street where she sold parlor trick accessories, the kind of stuff a low-rent Houdini or some backyard illusionist might want. Ironically, beneath the gimmick magic floor, she had a second store that catered to a different clientele. Real practitioners. Legitimate magic. It was ingenious, really. Not to mention an endless source of entertainment. Watching some two-bit sleight-of-hand hack sneering at a seemingly decrepit old man speaking Creole, not knowing the guy in front of him was a bona fide warlock, was hysterical. At least to me. This is different than last time. Some very big powers are involved in this one, and we're going to have to toe the line even more than before. Well, not us, obviously, but anyone we might bring in. A blind judge is the end-all, be-all, and it's a foregone conclusion when you send one of them after someone or something. They're the alpha dog of everywhere, except for maybe the deep, deep parts of the abyss and the veil, and even then I doubt anything would be eager to cross the thing. The dreadnought itself is like magically bulletproof, and it's the size of a monster truck, so I think it would be best for us to take this one step at a time. We'd worked out a system of talking at the red light, and, since he wasn't one to interrupt, a proclivity of mine despite my claims to the contrary, I could usually get my whole point across before it was time to go again. Since my signing was still pretty shoddy, we relied mostly on lip-reading and the tablet. We pulled up to The Last Love, the bar Gale owned and her misfit band of outcasts operated. It was still outside, almost unnaturally so. This wasn't a bustling street, but it wasn't usually this dead either. It seemed almost bleak, but not surprising, at least not to me. One of the biggest things about us regular folk who were both historically and perpetually underestimated is that we're good at tuning into our instincts, or can be. There was a something just under the surface, leaking out from under the door that we could feel as we approached the entrance, a dreadful feeling that was suffocating, and very unlike the usual cozy ambiance you'd find inside. The bar was notorious for never being empty, no matter the day or time. Never packed, but never completely thinned out. Just a steady flow of people coming and going. We stopped at the door. I checked the sidewalk in each direction before bending over to break the glass with my elbow. My jacket was imbued with a tougher texture than just the leather it was made out of, and it caved easily without wringing my bones. I turned to find Grove looking at me with disapproval. What? He poked the dangling cluster of warped wiring that hung off my necklace, asking in a rather abrupt fashion why I didn't use it. The incantation infused into the metal made it into a skeleton key, but it was a one-off trick and it took me a few hours to break the key back down. What if we need it later? I asked. The skeptical look he shot me revealed his strained tolerance. Just stow the righteous do-gooder bullshit, all right? We're already way out on a limb for this broad. If we get her out of this mess, she can buy another window. I shouldered the heavy door open and invited him to take the lead.
Gale is our friend, Grove added. You owe her a new window, and the respect of using her name.
This was a losing battle, and while I'd like to pretend it was an impasse, the truth was I'd end up paying for the window because it was the right thing to do. It was such a small thing, especially in the grand scheme of all that was happening and about to fall on our shoulders. But that's what made Grove what he was. Stalwart. To him, no matter the circumstance or situation, you did the right thing. Breaking the window to avoid an hour of work didn't pass muster.
Fine.
Once we were in the stairwell, we readied ourselves. I rolled up my left sleeve and unlatched the broken bat from the small of my back. Grove opened his jacket for better access to his guns and unlooped the big Western rifle that Casey had given him. Despite my aversion to guns, I'd fired that weapon and had a blast doing it. We'd gone to the range a few times a month to develop a better knowledge base for me to build on, in case I ever had to use a firearm.
I'd gotten pretty good until I learned that standing still at a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.